Hello and welcome to MATLAB Helper series on stock market with MATLAB. So in this series, we'll have a series of episodes in which we'll explain how we can design an interactive stock market application that actually fetches historical as well as real-time stock market data from the Yahoo Finance website and displays it in App Designer in MATLAB. So I welcome you all in the series and I hope to see you all in the next episodes. Welcome to the first episode in the series of Stock Market with MATLAB. So in this episode, we'll discuss how we can fetch historical stock market data from the Yahoo Finance website. So you can see on my screen that I have MATLAB open, and we'll use MATLAB to actually fetch the paid source of the Yahoo Finance website into MATLAB and save it in a variable. So we can begin by first going into the Yahoo Finance webpage and understanding where exactly the data is organized and placed in the paid source for that website. So I'm going to start Google Chrome now, and we can then view the paid source from there. I'm using Google Chrome because Google Chrome actually allows us to view the entire paid source in a very elegant format, and that actually eases the way or the time it takes to actually find the place where the data is placed in that paid source. So we'll search for Yahoo Finance from the search tab, and you'll find the very first link is the one we're looking for. Alright, so now we have the home page for the Yahoo Finance website, and since we are only interested in the data for specific companies, what we'll do is look up a company over here in the search bar within the website. Let's say, for example, we are interested in looking for the stock price of Apple company. We'll search for the type of Apple here and then click on Apple. So as you can see, we have the stock price or the stock data for the Apple company here, and apart from that, on the website we'll have a lot of other data, starting from summary to chart to conversation, statistics, historical data, and so on and so forth. So since we are for the time being only interested in fetching the historical data from this website for particular companies, what we'll do is we'll go into the historical data section over here and look what is displayed. So here we'll see that the time period here on the left is actually from 16th of February 2018 to 16th of February 2019. And also in frequency, we have three options here, either daily, weekly, or monthly. So let me just take you through what each of these terms mean. So the time period here actually means the time for which we want the data or the historical data. So this historical data can range from any time in the past to the date in which we are looking for it. Apart from that, you will check that the URL here is in the form of in.finance.com, and then quote, and then APL, then history, and then again APL. So let me just explain to you what each part in this particular URL means. So this particular phrase up to quote will remain the same no matter which company you open, and whatever date you choose the data for. However, these four letters represent the stock market symbol for the company. Since we have looked for Apple, this name has changed to AAPL. Now AAPL stands for the stock symbol for the Apple company. After that, we have the term history. Now, history here refers to the fact that we have looked for the historical data section. And after that, we again have APL. So we have looked for the historical data within Apple's old data that is displayed within this web page. So let's just check how this URL changes as we change the time period or the frequency or any other thing. So let's just change this time period to say 16th of February 2016 to 16th of Feb 2019, okay? And let's just make this frequency to weekly and apply these changes. As you will see that the URL has changed a bit. Up to history question mark, we have the same thing. But after that, we have a few more terms. So let me just explain what each of these terms mean. First of all, we have period one. Now, period one here refers to the start date here, which is 16th of February 2016. And this start period is followed by a big number, which is actually the start date in the Unix time format. Now, we have the start date in the format of 16th Feb 2016 here in time period section over here. However, in the URL, we'll always find that the date is displayed in the Unix time format. Now, what is the Unix time format? Actually, Unix time format is the time format that calculates the number of seconds that has elapsed after 1st of January 1970. So it will always be a big number that does not make any instinctive sense. After this big number, we have period 2, which represents the ending date that we have chosen, which is 16th of Feb 2019 in this case. And this again, this long number is the date itself, which is 16th of Feb 2019. So after that, we have interval and frequency. An interval and frequency are the same thing for the Yahoo website URL. And within interval, you will find that we have 1WK. Now, 1WK refers to 1 week. And since we have chosen weekly, we'll always have here 1 week as the value. Now, if we change this frequency to monthly, we'll find that we have here 1MO instead of 1WK, which is 1 week. Apart from that, nothing else has changed in this URL. And also, if we change the company over here, then the symbol will change over here. Okay. However, if we leave the dates unchanged over here, then the dates will not change. And even if the frequency is left the same, the frequency will not change. So depending upon what change you introduce in the web page, the URL changes. So if you change the company, then only these four letters, which is known as the ticker value, changes. And if you change the starting period or the starting date, only this particular number will change. And if you change the ending date, then only this number will change. Apart from that, if you change the frequency, then these two values will change after frequency and interval. So for the time being, we'll assume that we only want the data for Apple Inc. and that too for the period we have chosen. And we'll then go to the page source to view where the data in this table is stored. So let's just go into page source by right-clicking and going into page source. So we are opening the page source because we want to find where exactly in the page source is the data corresponding to this table is stored. Now I'll just increase the text size of my screen to let you all view it properly. Okay, so it took me some time to go through this particular page source and find out where exactly the data pertaining to that table was placed. However, I can tell you it right away that it's stored at a place after historical price store. Spelling is a bit wrong, historical price. So we only have one match to this particular string, and which is over here, and it is at the very end of this page source. All right, so you will find that after this particular string of historical price store and then some other string, you will find that we have some values that start with date and end at a curly brace over here. After that, we also have some amount other data, but that is not what is displayed in the table, is it? It's not. So what we'll do is we'll have to find a way that allows us to extract or kind of pull the data from each and every row that contains date in the page source and save it in some variable in MATLAB. Before that, we'll have to find a way to just extract the page source after the historical price store string in the page source itself. So what we can do is we can go into MATLAB now and see how we can do that. So opening MATLAB, I'll create a first script and name it stock market. Okay. So I'll open it and so within stock market, let's start the code by writing CLC clear and close all. For that, the command window, the workspace, as well as any figures or other windows that we have open, closes and clears. So we'll use the function webread to actually read the page source from the Yahoo Finance website and save it in a variable. So let's say we want to save the web page in a variable temp. Temp will be equal to webread of the URL. Now we need to write the URL within single quotes because it's a string value. So we'll go into Google Chrome again and we'll just copy this entire URL. For the time being, we are only interested in checking if we can actually read the page source and bring it into MATLAB. Okay, so let's just run this code and see if this works. Okay, it's asking me to rename the file. So I'll just rename it to something more distinct, let's say historical data. And with the no spaces. Let's just run this again. It might take some time to read the data and then save it in the variable temp, and there we have the data now. In workspace, we can see we have a variable called temp. If I open this, you'll find that I have the entire, let me just increase this. Yeah, so I have this entire page source saved in a char array. So just to check if we have been able to fetch the page source from the website that we wanted, I'll just go into the Yahoo Finance page source and go to the very top. And to check the first few lines, I'll just copy them here in the command window. Just check. So we have what starts with doc type HTML, then HTML atomic class NOJ, and then we have window.mark, we have window performance and every other thing. So if I go forward, you will find that we have all this data that we have been looking for. So this confirms that we have been able to actually fetch the Yahoo Finances page source into the temp variable. Close this and increase the screen size again. After this, what we'll need to do is we'll need to divide this page source into the unimportant bit and the important bit. So the important bit in the page source was after the string historical price store, right? So what we'll do is we'll just go to Chrome again and look for that string and copy this line, this particular few strings, and we'll use that in MATLAB in a while. So what we'll do is we'll create another variable temp1 and use the function strsplit to actually divide the char array or the page source stored in temp into two parts depending upon this particular string value. So if I run this code, you will find that get an error here. The reason for that is that we have misspelled the function. It should be strsplit, not split. So another one, and this should work now. Yeah. So in temp one, as you will see, we have two elements. The first one contains the first half of the source code, and the second element contains the part that contains the data from the table. So this is the data that was in the table, right? So what we'll do now is we'll just save the second part in temp1 and remove the first part, so that we only have that part in temp1 that we actually need for later coding. What we'll do is temp1 equals temp1, and then we'll save only the second part in temp1. Okay, so let's just run this again. It takes about 3 seconds to fetch the data and save it in the variable, but it's all dependent upon your internet connectivity and other things. All right, so it appears that I have again forgotten to write temp1 here. Okay, let's just run this, only this particular line. Temp1, okay, let's run the entire code now. Okay, so we have in temp1 only the only one element now, and it contains only the data we actually want. Okay, so this is all we'll be covering in this particular episode. So what we learned this episode was to analyze the page source of the Yahoo Finance website to find the place where we have the historical data stored, and after that we learned how to fetch that data into MATLAB and save it in a variable. After that we also learned how to separate the unimportant part from the important bit of the page source and save it in another variable. So in the next episode we'll discuss how we can extract the data from each row of the table, as well as we'll learn how to actually save the data in a table variable as well. So that is all from me.